This verse is saying that man was just made a shade lower than God. See, man was so close to God in his creation that it was actually possible for God and man to be in union in the person of Jesus Christ. If God could do that with man, then man was close to God in his creation. He was not made as a slave. He was not made as a subject of death. He was not made as a subject of sickness. He was not made as a subject of adversity. He was master. And the word that was used there was angelos. And they said, how come? That's really talking, is talking about angels. That's because that was translated out of the Septuagint. And in the Septuagint, which is the Greek rendering of the Old Testament, the people felt that this word should have been angels. So they left it as angels. So they translated it as angels. So really, that shouldn't have been translated from there. The word is actually God. Hope that's clear. And there's, I've met a translation or two that I've read a translation or two. Actually, even the Amplified Classic puts there one of the shades as God. Notice, it says, thou hast made him a little lower than God. God made man as much like himself as he could make a being. The marginal rendering says, it says, thou hast made him a little lower than angels. The margin says, thou hast made him but a shade lower than God. You know, look at this hall now. It's painted, right? Well, what would you call this color? I guess gray. What would you call the one under? Another shade of gray, a darker shade. Now, you know that the gray under is many shades darker than the one on top. Yeah, have you seen some things where one is just a little shade lower? Have you seen that? Yeah, just a shade lower. Just like you put one more coat of paint and then it changes it slightly, right? This verse is saying that man was just made a shade lower than God. See, man was so close to God in his creation that it was actually possible for God and man to be in union in the person of Jesus Christ. If God could do that with man, then man was close to God in his creation. He was not made as a slave. He was not made as a subject of death. He was not made as a subject of sickness. He was not made as a subject of adversity. He was master. He was made a kingly being, a queenly being. If you're a lady, say, I'm queen so-and-so. If you're a man, say, I'm king so-and-so. Amen. I'm King Tokes. Yeah, I'm kinging. Because I was made to king. I was made to reign. You know, in this sense, you can booga over the forces of hell. Amen. Not over other people, you know, because it shouldn't be arrogant. So that's it. He was made like God. He was made like God in God's image. And he had dominion. He called the shots. You know, he was told to tend that garden and to keep it. You know, there was a river there. How did he walk that river? Well, probably just walked on top of it. After all, he had dominion over everything. I guess he just walked on it. You know, all those animals. You see, whatever name Adam gave those things, that was the name God called them by. Yeah. He was in the God class. In the God class. You see, in Genesis, let's go back to Genesis. Genesis chapter 2. In giving some more details about man's creation, the Bible says, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Another translation says a conscious being. Another one says a speaking spirit. You notice that everything God made except man, he made by speaking them into being. But with man, he did man a little differently. He had created the earth. He took some clay, you know, or whatever kind of soil it was, whether it was loamy soil, I don't know, humus soil, whatever soil, or a mixture of them soils. But from the earth, from the ground, from the dust of the ground. And you know, scientists have discovered that the composition of the human body is quite similar to the earth. Yeah, it's a fact. If they were reading the Bible, they wouldn't have been surprised. The Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. Now, the word breath here, the word shama, you know, he breathed into him, is also the word inspiration. That word is also translated soul. That word is translated spirit in the Hebrew, you know. Divine inspiration is also translated that. So, God breathed into man. God took something from himself, which was spirit, and put it into man. You see, the life of God, I believe that Adam had the life of God. Because that must have been what God breathed into him. That life was so abundant that even after man had disobeyed God and had been cut away from God, the author of life, and had become spiritually dead, that it took almost 1,000 years for his body to catch up with that reality. That life conquered century after century. It was so abundant in his spirit. So abundant in his soul, so abundant in his body. Methuselah lived to be 969. Adam lived to be 930. That was quite some life. That was quite some life. It took quite a number of years before the lifespan to get considerably reduced. That was how abundant that life was. That even when man had become spiritually dead, there was still enough residue of life in his body to keep it going century after century. Amen. So he was made a kingly being. He was made to fellowship with God, to walk with God. Amen. And he had dominion over everything that God had made. Everything. We saw in Psalm 8 where the Bible says, thou hast put all things under his feet. So God crowned him with glory. Crowned him with honor. He was a king. Amen. Of the God class. Well, the second fact, we're talking about facts to assimilate. Talking about ruling and reigning in union with God. Second fact to assimilate is this. Adam committed high treason and sold out to the devil, thus losing his dominion, and he became spiritually dead. I'll say that again. Second fact we need to assimilate is that Adam committed high treason and sold out to the devil, thus losing his dominion, and he became spiritually dead. Well, God had told man, you may eat of all the fruit of the trees in the garden, but the tree that's in the midst of the garden, you know, don't eat of it. He said, the day you eat of it, you will die. Genesis 2, 17, 16 and 17. The literal Hebrew actually says, the day you eat of it, in dying. That's how it reads in the marginal rendering, a Cambridge reference edition. In dying, you will die. In dying spiritually, you will die physically. Now, Adam's body was neither mortal nor immortal. He had a perfect human body. God had set before him life and death. He could choose whichever one he wanted, and he chose death. He had a free will. He disobeyed God. Eve was deceived. Adam wasn't. Adam willfully disobeyed God. Adam knew the consequences of his action. He went ahead and did it. I'm Abraham's seed. I'm Abraham's seed. You know what God told Abraham? He said, through you shall all the families of the earth be blessed. He said, through you shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Now, I'm not in any illusion that I'm the one who is going to reach the whole world by myself. That's, you'll be an idiot to think that. But I'm saying we can have a wide reach. We can contribute our quota. We can bring our part to the table. We can bring our supply. Multiply. Be fruitful. Subdue. We don't have dominion over people, but we do have dominion over darkness, over unbelief, over the forces of hell. Amen. And we can multiply.